The subcommittee will come to order. After recognizing myself and Mr. Deutsch, the ranking member, for 5 minutes each for our opening statements, I will then recognize other members seeking recognition for 1 minute. We will then hear from our witnesses, and you'll notice an empty seat, but she's coming right over, getting through security. Without objection, the witnesses' prepared statements will be made a part of the record. Members may have 5 days to insert statements and questions for the record, subject to the length limitation in the rules, and the chair now recognizes herself for 5 minutes. This is the third hearing of our subcommittee that we've had on Egypt in a little over a year, demonstrating the importance of and our subcommittee's commitment to a volatile region, as well as they have on current U.S. policy toward our ally. The economic and security challenge that Egypt is facing right now, they're numerous, they're interdependent. It is extremely difficult, for example, for President potentially undermining the fragile political support he is leaning on to bring much-needed stability to the country. Conversely, if these economic reforms are not made soon, we may see a return of the unrest that we saw on Egyptian streets not too long ago. And it is in this context that Egypt is facing growing security threats from an expanding ISIS and its Sinai province affiliate, from Al-Qaeda linked groups, from militias, from extremists in Libya, and from particularly violent factions of the Muslim Brotherhood. Sinai province has formed terrorist cells that are targeting both Egyptian and Israeli military personnel and civilians, and has already killed hundreds of Egyptian soldiers, is continuing to target the peacekeeping operations, or the MFO, multinational force of observers in the Sinai, prompting the Pentagon to reposition U.S. troops and reconsider its presence there. There is more and more evidence that ISIS is attempting to link its operations in the Sinai and eastern Egypt to its presence in the western desert that sits along the extremely porous border with Libya. And there are growing reports of increased activity in southern Egypt and the Nile Valley, including in Greater Cairo, which has seen IEDs and shootings like the one that claimed the lives of 8 Egyptian policemen last month. While Egypt has been trying to keep up with these threats, it is increasingly clear that Egypt must also adopt a counterinsurgency approach that will allow it to get a handle on the problem before it gets worse. While the security situation remains a high priority, I'm extremely concerned by the government's attitude toward human rights, its crackdowns on civil society, its squashing of dissent. I was disappointed to see that the government froze the assets of yet another NGO just yesterday as part of an ongoing case which began in 2011 and targeted U.S. NGOs like IRI, whose president joins us here today. 43 NGO workers in this case were unjustly convicted in 2013, as we all remember, and I continue to call on President Sisi to do everything in his power, including working with the Egyptian parliament to work with the judicial system and find a way to pardon these workers as soon as possible. The government needs to find a way to open up civil society and allow Egyptians to participate and thrive in public life, or at risk exacerbating the very problems it is trying to avoid. In Egypt, the economy is perhaps the biggest challenge of all. Infusions of cash from the Gulf states, especially from Saudi Arabia, as well as loans from the World Bank, the IMF, and others, have managed to keep the economy afloat for the time being. But these investments aren't likely to stimulate growth in the long term, and the government has to make difficult structural reforms like reducing the bloated public payroll and passing the long-promised value-added tax. Unemployment, especially among youth, remains high, and around 60% of the population is poor and living on subsidies. One bright spot on the economic horizon has been the Egyptian-American Enterprise Fund, which Congress authorized in 2012 and has been successfully investing in Egypt's private sector to create jobs and support sustainable development. The Enterprise Fund, as with all the aid that Congress has appropriated, is an example of how much the United States wants to help Egypt as both an ally and a strong supporter of peace in that troubled region. But the Egyptian government also needs to help us with help us help them. And that includes allowing our economic support funds, or ESF monies, to be programmed. As of March 31st, there's a backlog of approximately $900 million in ESF for Egypt because the government has held up permits for our implementing partners on everything from democracy and governance to education and healthcare. That is why I was happy to sign a letter this month alongside Chairman Royce, Ranking Member Engel, and the co-chairs of the Tunisia caucus, asking the Secretary of State to reprogram up to $20 million of this money for Tunisia. This is not meant to be a slight against Egypt, but it makes little sense to continue letting these funds sit in the pipeline when they can be spent somewhere else, someplace like Tunisia, which is in desperate need of the funds and is willing to let us help. Egypt is an important strategic ally that is struggling on a number of fronts. And as we will discuss the challenges and opportunities for U.S. policy here today, I continue to believe that the best way to help is through encouragement and assistance as a friend. And with that, I'm pleased to yield to the ranking member, Mr. Deutsch of Florida.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chairman, and thanks for our witnesses for appearing today. First, I want to thank you, Madam Chairman, and Mr. Connolly for commissioning a series of GAO reports on our assistance to Egypt. The most recent report issued in April highlighted some of the serious challenges faced by the Department of Defense and the Department of State in securing compliance from the Egyptian government on end-use monitoring of our assistance. And I find this troubling. When we work together in partnership with the government, that government should not be hindering our ability to ensure that our assistance is going to where it's meant to go and doing what it is meant to do. Second, I want to unequivocally state that I value the U.S.-Egypt relationship. I value Egypt's role in the region. I want to see the Egyptian people prosper, and I particularly want to thank the Egyptian Foreign Ministry for the condolences it sent to the victims of the horrific terror attack in the chairman in my home state just days ago. But it's becoming increasingly difficult to discuss the U.S.-Egypt relationship outside of the security context. And so while I have supported and I continue to support the Sisi government and the president's commitment to fighting terror and keeping peace in the region, I am quite troubled by the direction of the country when it comes to civil society and human rights. I do understand that it can be challenging to balance security and human rights. Egypt is coming out of a period of great turmoil. As Egypt's leaders look around the region, they see numerous threats to stability, and there is no doubt that we share our Egyptian partners' commitment to preventing ISIS and its affiliates from dominating Sinai. But I urge our friends not to silence the discourse on human rights. Engage with civil society, democracy, and human rights activists. Work together. Have the tough conversations. A lack of inclusive governing will yield greater instability. One area I'm deeply concerned about is the foreign funding of NGOs case. Now, this subcommittee has held many hearings on the arrest, trial, and conviction of the 43 NGO employees. Mr. Green, you've been present for several of those hearings. The idea that the government is now going to reopen the NGO trial and add new defendants is deeply disturbing. The only reason this case should be reopened is to pardon each and every one of the 43 individuals. And I want to commend the chair for her continued advocacy on behalf of those who were so wrongfully convicted in this case. President Sisi has been tasked with the difficult job of reviving Egypt's economy after years of mismanagement. I want to commend him for taking seriously recommendations for reform from the World Bank and the IMF. Last year, the economy grew at its fastest rate since 2010. Buoyed by generous financial support from the Gulf, Egypt has found some economic relief. But diminished foreign currency reserves are making it increasingly difficult to import fuel and food, and water shortages are beginning to impact rural areas. The government must continue to work with international financial institutions to push ahead with necessary reforms to meet these challenges. On the security front, Egypt faces dangerous threats from the Sinai. I commend the Egyptian military for its commitment to rooting out terrorism and to taking seriously the need to improve government services and infrastructure for the people of Sinai. I extend condolences to the dozens of Egyptian soldiers their families who have lost their lives fighting this terrorism. And President Sisi deserves to be commended for speaking out against violent Islamic extremism. In addition, I want to thank the Egyptian government for its continued cooperation with Israel in the Sinai and its continuing efforts to prevent Hamas from using tunnels to smuggle dangerous weapons to Gaza. President Sisi has made clear his interest in brokering peace between Israel and the Palestinians, and both have welcomed his involvement in the process. With trust building on both sides, he can be a strong voice for two states living side by side in peace and security. Our $1.3 billion of security assistance to Egypt is critical in the fight against ISIS, both in the Sinai and in Libya. The fragile political situation in Libya has created space for ISIS to use Libya as a training ground for its fighters. To that end, assisting Egypt in controlling its 1,100-kilometer border with Libya is essential to preventing ISIS fighters from launching cross-border attacks or using Egypt as a transit point to the greater Middle East. I applaud the administration's recognition of the need to refocus our assistance on counterterrorism. The threats facing Egypt are not countered with tanks and planes alone, but with a strong intelligence apparatus and regional and bilateral intelligence sharing, and we have a real opportunity here to help Egypt confront and root out terrorism. I want to see the people of Egypt succeed. I want to see the future of Egypt that so many millions poured into the streets demanding. I believe President Sisi wants his country and his people to thrive, but to do so will take real political will to confront terrorism, to reform the economy, and to give space for civil society to grow and to thrive. These are not easy tasks, nor are they accomplished without the support of the United States. And I look to our witnesses today to help us better understand how we can be an effective partner for Egypt while continuing to advocate for the basic human rights and values that this country was founded upon. And with that, I yield.
Well said. Thank you so much, Mr. Deutsch. I will now recognize members for statements that they would like to make. Mr. Wilson of South Carolina.
Thank you, Chairman Ileana Ros-Lehtinen and Ranking Member Deutsch for holding this important hearing. Over the last decade, Egypt has been faced with political and social instability. Egypt has been and will continue to be a valued ally in an unstable region in support of American interest and worldwide interest in the global war on terrorism. I'm grateful my son Julian served with the Army National Guard in Egypt with Operation Bright Star, an indication of U.S.-Egyptian cooperation, and he was impressed by the talented citizens of Egypt. I believe that we need to continue our military and economic support while we closely monitor whether the money that's being provided is wisely spent. Egypt continues to face a growing threat from Islamic terrorists, most recently the Egypt Air flight that was destroyed in the eastern Mediterranean Sea, to the Metrojet flight that exploded over the Sinai on October 31st, killing 209 Russian tourists. Egypt exists within a very dangerous neighborhood and is very critical that we maintain our support, also maintaining our moral responsibilities, promoting IRI as a very positive NGO. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses regarding how the United States can help ensure that Egypt is back on track to be a success for prosperity for its citizens.
Thank you very much, and congratulations on your son's military service. It's a long tradition there. Good for you, Joe. Mr. Connolly of Virginia.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and thank you for our collaboration on the GAO report our friend Ted Deutsch cited. I think it's, you know, the relationship with Egypt is a critical relationship. It's got to be one we work out. But American patience is not unlimited. And Egyptian leverage in the relationship is also not unlimited. There is a desire in this country and a growing desire in this body to hold the current Egyptian government accountable for human rights violations, accountable for security infringements, accountable for how it treats civil society, especially the NGOs we have worked with. I met with a lot of those NGOs when I was in Cairo. And I think the Egyptian government was counting on the United States, once the Americans got out of the country, to frankly wash the hands of the Egyptian staff and volunteers of these NGOs. That's not the case. And I hope this hearing makes that very clear, and I know Ambassador Green's going to make that point. We stand by those brave young men and women who are trying to make for a better society in their own country. And I know we're going to hear more about that in this hearing. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Connolly. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Rohrabacher. We're pleased to recognize you for any opening statement you might make.
Thank you very much for holding this hearing, and I appreciate you and the ranking member and the work that you've put into this. Let me just note that I am chairman, co-chairman with the Egyptian caucus, and as such, I have been to Egypt a number of times in recent days. And let me just state for the record that I believe that President El-Sisi and the democratic people in Egypt who want to have a legitimate democratic government are under attack by forces that would murder them. So whatever we are doing when we're talking about Egypt, let's understand we're talking about people who are fighting forces that would murder them and create a caliphate that would be allied with terrorists. In fact, if President El-Sisi and his efforts are defeated, you could expect a collapse of resistance to this radical Islamic terrorist movement that threatens the world. They are at an equivalent of where we were at immediately after Pearl Harbor. The fact is, what did we do when we were under attack? Yes, there were things that we would never tolerate in our society today. We put large numbers of American citizens, Japanese Americans, in camps. Yes, that did not indicate what type of government or type of country we had, but it did indicate that we are at war with an enemy that had murdered our own people and would continue to do so. That's what's going on in Egypt today. Those people are on the front lines. The President El-Sisi and his democratic allies and the moderate Muslim community there are under attack by the very same terrorists that would, again, create a caliphate and threaten the entire world. We have faced this terrorism here. We have faced it in Orlando. We have faced it in San Bernardino. We have faced it in the Boston Marathon. This radical Islamic terrorism threat to the world is something that we need to recognize, and we need to recognize that people like President El-Sisi and the good people of Egypt are on the front lines, and we need to back them as much as we can so that we can, so because we know if they lose, we lose. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Rohrabacher. Ms. Frankel of Florida.
Madam Chair, I thank the witnesses for being here, and I would like to hear what they have to say. So I yield back to you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Frankel. And Dr. Yoho of Florida? Okay, thank you so much to our witnesses. First, we are pleased to welcome back a great friend of our subcommittee, Ambassador Mark Green, a former colleague of ours. He's the president of the International Republican Institute. He's a former U.S. ambassador to Tanzania and served as a member of Congress representing Wisconsin's 8th District from 97 to 2007. It's always a delight to see you, Mr. Ambassador. I love following you on Twitter. Next, we welcome Mr. I'm going to try my best, Mokhtar Awad, who is a research fellow in the Program on Extremism at George Washington University's Center for Cyber and Homeland Security. Prior to this, Mr. Awad worked as a research associate at the Center for American Progress. We welcome you to our subcommittee, Mr. Awad. And lastly, we welcome Ms. Amy Hawthorne, who is the Deputy Director for Research at the Project on Middle East Democracy. Prior to this, Ms. Hawthorne served as a resident senior fellow with the Atlantic Council's Middle East Program, where she focused on U.S. policy toward Egypt. We welcome you also, Ms. Hawthorne. We're pleased to have all of you here today. As I had said, your statements will be made a part of the record, and we will now hear your synthesized version, starting with our friend Mark.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Ranking Member Deutsch, and members of the committee. I appreciate the opportunity to testify. And I also want to thank you for the tremendous support that you have shown, that all of you have shown, relating to Egypt's indefensible NGO foreign funding trial. As you know, and as has been alluded to, Egypt wrongfully and outrageously convicted 43 innocent staff from IRI, NDI, Freedom House, and others. And I'm grateful that you continue to make pardons for these victims your highest priority in discussions with the top Egyptian officials. 1 year ago, Madam Chair, I testified on Tunisia's democratic tradition. I offered optimism about the progress it was making and suggested that it deserved additional support. I wish I could be similarly optimistic here today, but sadly, I believe that Egypt is moving on an uncertain and dangerous trajectory. There is no doubt, as many of you have said, that Egypt remains a very important ally and strategic partner for America's interests in that part of the world. But there's also little doubt, however, that the problems that are in Egypt continue to get worse. Polarization and the threat of extremism are on the rise. President Sisi's counterterrorism campaign is making precious little headway, in my opinion, while risking even greater alienation of the local population. Instead of forging an effective effort to root out extremists and extremism, I worry that the government's primary response seems to be an even greater crackdown on dissent. There has been an increase in extrajudicial forced disappearances, over 1,800 reported cases in 2015 alone. Mass trials and collective convictions based on vague charges of harming national interests have become the norm. Madam Chair, it is my strong belief and IRI's long experience that counterterrorism and military operations alone will never be a sufficient response to genuine, real extremist threats that they face. Egypt needs to enlist the help of its civil society, not crush it. It should avoid measures like its 2013 anti-protest law that curtails citizens' ability to participate peacefully in public meetings, or its 2015 counterterrorism law that punishes journalists who stray from official government narratives. President Sisi has defended the crackdown in civil society, calling it fourth-generation warfare. The notion that media and civil society groups that aren't lockstep with the government are somehow waging war against the Egyptian state. Madam Chair, history warns us of the dangers when conspiracy theory becomes official policy. Just ask those 43 wrongly convicted NGO workers who are still unable to travel freely in some parts of the world, and the Egyptian staff who have been cut off from their families over these years. Now the Egyptian government appears to be doubling down on its approach. As was mentioned, it has reopened and apparently widened the NGO case, with as many as 47 Egyptian and international organizations now being threatened with criminal prosecution. But despite this bleak picture, IRI and other international organizations still hope that Egypt will one day reclaim its strong civil society and citizen-responsive government traditions. At IRI, we continue to work with peaceful, democratic Egyptians through programs taking place offshore in third country locations. We still hope to assist civil society and political party reformers to improve governance and to combat the alienation and anger that extremism depends upon. We are proud that, despite the many obvious challenges, a recent independent evaluation of our Egypt programs found promising results and reason for continued engagement. Madam Chair, I respectfully offer the following recommendations for the subcommittee to consider. First, since Egyptian obstinacy has apparently created a backlog of U.S.-Egypt assistance funds to the tune of $700 million or more, I would urge the U.S. to redirect much of that backlog to places where significant democratic strides are being made, places like Tunisia. Second, the funds that are going to Egypt, I believe a significant portion of that should be used to engage democratic actors and build their skills for a future democratic breakthrough. And then finally, U.S. administration officials, members of Congress, and staff at every level should continue to raise the foreign funding case at every opportunity. We should make it clear that reopening the case and expanding it is unconditionally unacceptable. And of course, continue to insist that the only solution to the 2013 verdict is full pardons by President Sisi. Madam Chair, a recent Economist article suggested that if Egypt does well, it can lift the region, whereas its collapse would represent a threat to the entire Middle East and Europe. I would add the United States to that list as well. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Very good. Thank you, Ambassador Green. Mr. Awad?
Madam Chairperson, Ranking Member Deutsch, members of the subcommittee, thank you for this opportunity to be here to talk about security in Egypt. In fact, I've recently returned from a long research trip to that country where we've met with colleagues, top security officials, and went to areas like the Western Desert and Suez Canal area to see the situation there on the ground for ourselves. I'm going to provide a threat assessment of the situation in Egypt with some relevant recommendations. The most important thing to understand is that Egypt is facing what is the deadliest and most lethal complex insurgency in its modern history. Since the Muslim Brotherhood was ousted from power in July 2013, at least 900 security service members lost their lives to an array of terrorist groups seeking to topple the government. The threat in Egypt comes from three different geographic theaters and three different types of groups. First, there is northeastern Sinai, where Islamic State-affiliated militants wage insurgency against the Egyptian government and pose a severe threat to Egypt and Israel. The second is in the Nile Valley, the heart of Egypt, where 97% of the population lives. There, also Islamic State-affiliated elements, some Al-Qaeda elements, although small in number, and other violent Islamist groups suspected to be affiliated with some members inside the Muslim Brotherhood also seek to topple the government there. Finally, the Western Desert, with the vast border with Libya, the Islamic State is attempting to build a presence there. Let me focus a little bit on the situation in the Sinai. You will find in my written testimony detailed information on the Nile Valley and the Western Desert. The situation in the Sinai continues to be quite challenging. Since the fall of 2014, the local jihadi group called Ansar Beit al-Maqdis, or the champions or supporters of Jerusalem, saw its capabilities increase significantly as it pledged allegiance to the Islamic State. Since then, they were able to launch large-scale offensives on the ground, culminated in July 1st, 2015 attack that attempted to hold parts of a city called Sheikh Zawayed in North Sinai. Only after a 12-hour-plus battle, the intervention of Egyptian F-16s was a jihadi threat neutralized. Since then, the Egyptians launched a massive counter-offensive that has had some successes. It should be noted that the jihadists in North Sinai do not control any population centers. Also, their areas of operation have largely been contained. Despite these successes, they have shifted their tactics and they've used more IEDs and focused on terrorist attacks like the downing of the Russian airliner in October 2015. As a result, the first quarter of 2016 is the deadliest 3 months on record for Egyptian troops in North Sinai. The frequency of attacks has also increased. But again, they have not been back to the same qualitative capabilities that they had prior to July. Quickly on the Nile Valley and the Western Desert, the most important things to understand there is that the situation is comparatively better compared to the Sinai. With that being said, although the government has had great successes in the Nile Valley, cracking down on some of the violent Islamists connected to the Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda, the Islamic State has recently been attempting to bring armed insurgency closer to Cairo. However, these attempts have been thus far checked. And finally, of course, in the Western Desert, smugglers continue to operate, and as pressure increases against the Islamic State in Libya, they're more likely going to look more into the Western Desert to find ways to entrench themselves there. Finally, let me offer some recommendations. I think for these reasons, a continued security relationship with Egypt is, of course, important for U.S. strategic interests in the region. However, the relationship should reflect the changing nature of the challenges Egypt faces in confronting asymmetric threats from non-state actors and advanced U.S. interests. The Obama administration's announcement that starting in fiscal year 2018, the U.S. will channel FMF funds towards procurement in four categories, counterterrorism, border, maritime, and Sinai security, is a good basis for the future of the FMF program. This pathway for updating U.S.-Egypt cooperation is sound and will require close coordination and support between Congress and the administration in order to implement it effectively. The U.S.-Egypt relationship requires new anchors that go beyond security, but also requires updating its security relationship. It should be built on mutual trust, respect, and frankness. The United States should encourage Cairo to implement a comprehensive counterinsurgency strategy in the Sinai that integrates technologies and training with economic development and tribal outreach in order to effectively defeat terrorist elements, all while minimizing collateral damage. Both governments should ensure that defense officials are able to discuss issues related to counterinsurgency, frankly, and be granted the access necessary to adequately provide training and assistance. More cooperation is also needed with Egypt's General Intelligence Directorate and the Ministry of Interior, specifically the State Security. These institutions are key actors in Egypt's fight against terror and thus warrant this further engagement. Egypt should implement a comprehensive counterterrorism and countering violent extremism strategy that in part cracks down on human rights abuses and improves conditions in prisons to combat radicalization. All assistance should be on the basis of advancing U.S. interests and providing the necessary weapons and training that can help Egypt address its security challenges in ways that align with U.S. interests and values. Finally, U.S. security cooperation and assistance with Egypt should be conditioned on Egypt's performance in the security field itself instead of political and economic reforms. Look forward to getting into more details in the Q&A. Thank you.
Mr. Wadd, thank you so much. Ms. Hawthorne.
Good morning. Thank you, Madam Chair, Ranking Member Deutsch, distinguished members of the committee. I'm honored to be here today to testify alongside my esteemed colleagues. I would also like to commend the Chair and Congressman Connolly for their leadership on a series of crucially important GAO reports that have shed light on U.S. aid to Egypt, and for the subcommittee's leadership on holding regular hearings on Egypt over the past few years. With your permission, I will summarize the key points of my written testimony.
Please do. Thank you so much.
Egypt remains important to the United States for all the reasons that have been mentioned this morning. But nearly 3 years after now President el-Sisi led the military overthrow of Mohamed Morsi's government, Egypt is headed in the wrong direction with regard to political developments, its economy, its security situation, and in many ways, it has become a more difficult partner for the United States. At present, relations with Egypt present more challenges than opportunities for the United States. With regard to the political situation, as detailed in fact sheets that I attached to my testimony, there is an intense human rights campaign of repression and other political crackdown that is far worse than anything that took place under Mubarak or under former President Morsi. I will spare you the details, but suffice it to say that thousands of Egyptians have been locked up. Conditions in detention centers and prisons are thought to involve abuse and torture and the potential radicalization of inmates who are held in these conditions. Civil society and independent human rights groups are under an intense campaign of repression. Blasphemy cases and prosecution of Egyptians for expressing their opinions and their views, including against Coptic Christians, are at record highs in Sisi's Egypt. As the leading human rights activist Gamal Eid wrote in a recent article in the New York Times, when independent political activity and civil society groups are crushed, you run the risk in Egypt of moving toward a situation that was similar to that which existed in Gaddafi's Libya or Saddam Hussein's Iraq, in which there are no mediating institutions, no spaces for citizens to gather peacefully and organize and mobilize with their government. And this creates a society that is far more brittle and far less prepared to deal with turbulence and conflict and risks falling into violence. On the economic front, although President Sisi has spoken often of improving the economy and the Egyptian government has taken some important steps, Egypt remains mired in economic problems. By many economic indicators, the economy is getting worse. And most concerning, I don't see a clear sign coming from the Egyptian leadership about a sound economic policy of reforms to turn the situation around. I would also note that one of the key features of Sisi's Egypt, which is an increased role for the military in the civilian economy, is completely antithetical to the development of competitive free market economy that many Egyptians and the U.S. would like to see develop. With regard to security, my colleague Mokhtar has described the situation far better than I ever could, but I would just like to underscore that there are genuine concerns that Sisi's strategy of combating a real and genuine terrorist threat that Egypt faces runs the risk of being so broad and indiscriminate and brutal that it may actually worsen the very problem it's trying to address by expanding the pool of Egyptians aggrieved against their government and susceptible to radicalization. With regard to U.S. relations, although President Sisi has often said that he seeks a strong relationship and a strategic relationship with the United States, the actions of many in the Egyptian government suggest otherwise. This is a government that has refused to pardon innocent American citizens who have been wrongly convicted on trumped-up charges relating to their work with NGOs, that puts American citizens on trial, that detains American citizens, deports them from the airport. with no explanation. That constantly features negative images and attacks on the United States in its media. As the recent GAO report on security assistance pointed out, refuses to cooperate in many key aspects of U.S. Security assistance. We need to work with Egypt. Although it is not easy, the United States must continue to partner with this government while showing strong signs of concern about the trajectory of the country. In the question and answer, I'd be pleased to describe some details about the ways I think we should restructure our ESF, our FMF program, in order to develop a course correction with regard to our policies in Egypt. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Excellent testimony from all three. I will start the question and answer period. Ambassador Green, I completely agree that if the Egyptian government keeps stifling dissent and does not allow for more citizen participation, it will likely end up destabilizing the country even further. You mentioned that your legal team had looked into Egypt's their government's authority to issue pardons to the 43 NGO staff, and that you had concluded that it is completely within its power to do so. And when I have raised this issue with Egyptian officials, I've been told that the biggest obstacle is the judiciary's ongoing review and then reform of the penal code, which would then need to be passed by the parliament. What is your understanding of the judiciary's role in this process, and how can we help Egypt to move these pardons forward and to start seeing civil society as an ally in its development and not as a problem?
Thank you, Madam Chair, for that question. First off, as you alluded to, our best legal information is that they can move immediately to issue pardons. I would note, as some of you have pointed out, they do not seem to have a barrier in reopening the case and adding defendants. It's only pardoning the convicted that they seem to hesitate over. And again, we simply don't see legal barriers to it. They're more political obstacles that they keep raising. Madam Chair, I think the best answer to the question that you posed about how to move this forward is really, quite frankly, to continue doing what you have been doing and others on the committee have been doing, and that's raise this every single time. Egypt is an important ally, and as an important ally, we need to speak frankly and make it very clear to them at every single possible opportunity that this matters to us, their treatment of American citizens, as well as citizens of their own country, but particularly American citizens, is something that matters to us and we will not let stand. So I think making that case over and over again. And then finally, just on the logical point, as some of you have said, they are making it hard for us to help them. We wish to see all of us, Egypt, succeed. We need Egypt to succeed. And the lessons of our experience as a nation, as well as organizations like NDI and IRI, is that for security to be sustainable, it must involve citizens and civil society.
Thank you very much, sir. And Mr. Awad, you testified that relative to the Sinai, the Egyptian security forces have so far been able to frustrate ISIS and other violent groups in the Nile Valley. What elements does Egypt need to include in its counterinsurgency strategy if it is to stop ISIS from expanding further? And what do you see as ISIS's strategy in Egypt as it attempts to link its operations with those in Libya?
So let me discuss the situation in the Sinai. Counterinsurgency really relates to the Sinai. The issue is that the Egyptian government and the military has articulated different parts of the strategy: economic development, tribal outreach in an informal way, and beginning to update some of the doctrine and integrating intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance methods in how they are fighting the terrorists. Problem is, as thus far, we don't necessarily see a unified central command that is implementing a counterinsurgency strategy. Different parts, again, are articulated. There's supposed to be a command that is for countering terrorism and economic development of the Sinai. However, it remains to be seen if, in fact, we will see the Egyptian government saying that it's going to do counterinsurgency. Problem is, some officials don't even like the term insurgency, but that's a whole other set of issues. When it comes to the Islamic State, as I've written in the West Point Sentinel in multiple articles, the Islamic State looks at Egypt as, most importantly, a base of operations that can be used to launch attacks against Israel. This is the case of the Sinai. Also, it can link the Sinai and the Libyan theater. So being able to have assets in the Western Desert that can secure the smuggling routes, being able to have assets in the Nile Valley that can continue that route from the Western Desert to Sinai is key and vital. Egypt also has a lot of Western interests, tourist targets, so the Islamic State looks at it as a place where it can do external operations against Western targets. Finally, Egypt is an untapped reservoir from their perspective of recruits. We look at tiny Tunisia and the thousands of people it exported to that group, whereas in Egypt, only a fraction of that number. So the Islamic State is looking to try and recruit as much as possible inside Egypt to feed its different branches, but also to increase its operations in Egypt proper.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Mr. Deutsch is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. We've had a lot of discussion about the security issue and the human rights issue and how to bridge them. And I wanted to come at this a different way. President Sisi has taken a leading role in countering violent Islamic extremism, and his has been a needed and welcome voice in the region. The question, though, is not about how we perceive it. The question is how do the Egyptian people perceive it, number one. And given the crackdown on Islamists, is President Sisi able to be a voice of influence in the broader region? Ms. Hawthorne?
Thank you. That's a crucial question. I believe that many Egyptians do support President Sisi's approach, and he does continue to enjoy support from large parts of the Egyptian population. But first of all, that support has notably declined in the past year as problems in Egypt have mounted. And secondly, I believe there are many Egyptians who are very worried and fearful of President Sisi's counterterrorism approach. In fact, many of these Egyptians are the very ones that the government and state institutions need to be able to reach to convince them not to turn to violence, not to turn to radicalization. And it's this constituency of Egyptian citizens who themselves or their friends or their families have been arrested, detained, tortured, subject to other kinds of mistreatment, convicted in trials that lack any semblance of due process. I think for those Egyptians, they are looking for Egyptian leadership that has the moral authority to talk about values of tolerance and acceptance and human rights that are at the core of countering any message from ISIS. And that is, I think, a very serious concern. President Sisi speaks out against Islamic radicalism, which is crucial, but the other half of the equation, which is all of the other things that are needed to create, to diminish the appeal of these groups, is really missing at this time.
Okay, Mr. Awad, can you just follow up that I understand, and we've spoken about the concerns that so many of us share on the human rights front and on civil society. And clearly for those segments of Egyptian society who are trying to express themselves, we understand that those problems. But more broadly throughout the region, is the position that President Sisi has taken, speaking out against these radical Islamist views, how is that being received? Throughout the broader region, understanding that there are human rights issues, there are civil society issues throughout the broader region as well, which we have to talk about, but just specifically on his willingness to speak out like this, Mr. Awad, what impact is that having?
Well, we can't say that there's much impact. However, I can say that definitely people across the region appreciated the rhetoric coming from the president of a major country in the Arab world to speak in such frank terms against Islamic extremism and against many of these extremists. However, for Egypt to have impact, it will have to lead by example. This is not necessarily something that we've seen. Again, we've seen parts of a strategy articulated when it comes to countering violent extremism, or CVE, but the government hasn't completely established a unified strategy that can set an example for less stable countries to follow or aspire to.
Ambassador Green, how do we, again, getting back to human rights and civil society, the frustration that we've expressed, and again, it's an issue I think Mr. Connolly talked about, the expectations that we have, and but I again, instead of just viewing this as what we expect and how Egypt receives the message that we're sending them, how do we speak to Egyptian leaders that about human rights in a way that that resonates with them and that aligns with their interests? Is there a way to do that?
I think the way that we do that is that we suggest to them over and over again, and we have plenty of lessons to point to, that in the long run, for security to be sustainable, it must have citizen buy-in, particularly from the next generation. Young people have to have a stake in a vibrant Egyptian culture and government, and that means that there has to be a space for citizens to engage and have a voice in their government. That, I think, is what we talk about over and over again. And if I might, just to add on to what we've just heard from your previous question, Egypt is clearly important to America's interests and to the interests of many in the region. However, I think everyone recognizes that Egypt's economy, as bad as it is, would be even more horrendous if it were not for it being buffeted and held up by outside assistance. And the same thing is true with the military. So while there is stability in one sense, I think many recognize that in so many ways it's hollow, that unless they make these investments in some kind of citizen engagement, they can never truly and sustainably be secure and have that bright future that every one of us wants to see.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Deutsch. Mr. Wilson of South Carolina.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Ambassador Green, thank you very much for your service, and I am really so pleased about your presidency of IRI, the International Republican Institute. I wish more American people knew about IRI, also National Democrat Institute. It's a great example of working together, both parties, promoting democracy around the world, and I had the opportunity 26 years ago, it was life-changing to me to be an election observer as a state senator in Bulgaria, June 10, 1990. I'll never forget it. It was extraordinary to see the country come to life after fascism, Nazism, communism, and then it gave me the opportunity to invite, and I had a member of parliament, Stefan Stoyanov, and Ambassador Elena Paparova come and observe our election. So it was eye-opening. And then I had the opportunity, due to IRI, to visit in Bratislava, Slovakia, to Novosibirsk, Siberia. What a difference you make. And I had the great opportunity to have Ambassador Peter Burian as an election observer from Slovakia in South Carolina, of all things, where he unjustly accused me of arranging for half of the voters to have Slovak heritage. It was just a coincidence as we were at the polling locations, but what a difference IRI makes, so thank you. In your written testimony, you stated that President Sisi's concerted counterterrorism campaign in the Sinai shows few signs of progress in eliminating the very real extremist threat that is sadly on the rise. Based on this observation, could you explain the impact of the really bizarre reports that the U.S. may be withdrawing from the Sinai, and what would that do to the prospect of destroying ISIL-Daesh on the Sinai Peninsula?
Thank you, Congressman. Thank you for the kind words. And as you know, IRI and NDI are joined at the hip. We are sister organizations working closely together. I'm not sure I'm qualified to give you a thorough assessment on the security front, but I would say that we do believe the U.S. must stay engaged with Egypt. It's a crucial partner of ours in the region. So I would certainly not suggest withdrawal in any way, shape, or form.
Well, to me, it's very clear. We either stop ISIL-Daesh overseas, or we will see them again here, as Congressman Rohrabacher has so eloquently pointed out. Mr. Awad, how would you characterize the impact of U.S. military assistance to Egypt? Has it been used effectively?
If I may, just to comment on the issue of the MFO in North Sinai.
Yes, please.
Our troops are not there to fight ISIS, so the issue of removal is not taking them out of Egypt necessarily, but a more secure location in the South Sinai. So it won't have necessarily a negative impact on the fight against ISIS. The troops are there to observe the peace treaty between Egypt and Israel, and that's no longer as acute of a problem as it used to be. So it's for our troop protection. We're not removing our people from Egypt, or we're not limiting the pressure that's applied against the Islamic State there. For the most part, I think there's room for improvement when it comes to how our military assistance is lining up with Egyptian priorities and how that's advancing our point of view towards counterinsurgency in a place like Sinai. When it comes to the use of Apaches, F-16s, they've been effective, as I've noted, as the situation escalated in the Sinai. It's not so much an issue of the major weapon systems that would provide them, but how best to provide them ISR-related technologies, drones, and things along those lines, but at the same time ensuring that they'll be used in an effective strategy. So we've made some gains. It's doing some work, but there's a lot that can be done with the type of weapons that we give them. But at the end of the day, there needs to be an effective counterinsurgency strategy, an articulated strategy that we can actually latch onto and provide the necessary equipment for.
Thank you very much. And Ambassador Green, how could you explain, sadly, the relatively low voter turnout in Egypt's elections? What can the United States do to encourage greater participation in the political process?
Well, obviously, the most important things that can be done are by the Egyptian government itself. It is creating meaningful opportunities. Where outcomes are predetermined or preordained, people see less reason to participate. And so genuine choices, genuinely citizen-centered choices at the ballot box are the long-term answer. We recognize in a challenging security situation there may be intermediate steps and there may be a path to be followed, but clearly there has to be some hope for Egypt's young people that they will get back to the traditions that they have had of civil society being vibrant and citizen-centered government being the norm.
And again, I've seen it firsthand with IRI and NDI. Again, it's fun when you visit these countries and you can't tell who's R and who's D, which is amazing. But working together and by encouraging youth groups, different civic groups to participate, it's very positive, and I wish you continued success, and I yield back to the chairperson.
Thank you so much, Mr. Wilson, and now we will go to, Mr. Trott. Right? Yes.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you so much.
I want to thank Ranking Member Deutsch for scheduling this hearing, and obviously, a discussion of the relationship between Egypt and the United States is very important because there are strategic importance to the relationship. I want to mention, I didn't get here in time to make an opening statement, but I wanted to mention to the panel that I'm very honored today. I have a large Coptic community in my district, and so for the first time in the history of the House, Father Mina from the Orthodox Church in Troy, Michigan is here. He's going to open the House and lead the House in prayer later this morning.
Terrific.
So, it's a wonderful honor, and I'll be happy to welcome him with the speaker in about an hour. My question goes to the events that happened a few weeks ago in Minya, when the elderly woman was stripped naked and paraded around the city. And I just want each of the panelists to speak to, you know, what's going to be done in response to that outrageous incident. Is President Sisi going to be supportive of a rule of law solution? Are we going to engage in ridiculous reconciliation sessions. What's going to happen there? What can we do to help get the right result with respect to that outrageous behavior and incident? And then generally, with respect to religious minorities, how can Congress help move the needle to make sure the situation continues to improve, particularly for the Copts in Egypt?
I guess I will start with that one. First, in response to one of the earlier questions, and this actually feeds into your very important question, with regard to how the U.S. can engage with Egypt on human rights and civil society and talk about the ways in which upholding these norms and values is in Egypt's interest. I would note that in recent meetings with visiting U.S. Congressional delegations and with other foreign visitors, President Sisi has reportedly stated that the West should not hold Egypt to unfair Western human rights standards and that we should create sort of a lower standard or exceptions for Egypt's human rights performance. But in fact, it's very important to keep in mind that these standards are not Western standards. Many of them are enshrined in Egypt's new constitution of 2014. Egypt is also a signatory to several key international human rights instruments, and human rights organizations and quasi-official bodies in Egypt monitor and uphold human rights. So when President Sisi and other Egyptian officials make that assertion, I think we need to be ready to respond with the fact that these are really Egyptian norms and Egyptian demands as well as universal ones. With regard to the very troubling events that you referenced in Minya, frankly, this is one of the most disturbing things that I've read about of all the incredibly disturbing things that have been happening in Egypt recently. And sadly, it's a part of a pattern of communal tensions that lead to violent attacks on Coptic Christians with really no recourse and no justice. One of the disturbing elements of this incident was that it really only came to light because of dogged local reporting and information on social media by Egyptian citizens. The Egyptian government was originally prepared not to mention it. President Sisi has spoken about this incident and has vowed that the perpetrators will be brought to justice. But I must say that under Sisi, under former President Morsi, under former President Mubarak, there was a terrible and disturbing pattern of lack of follow-through for these attacks against Copts and other minorities in Egypt. Lots of nice words, but very little follow-through for accountability and the rule of law. The problem is that the justice system, the judiciary in Egypt today, is in many cases seems incapable of rendering justice. And there is an increasingly intolerant environment in Egyptian society against those who are different, which might include Copts and others who really are part of the fabric of Egyptian society. I think that it's very important that all visiting Americans, U.S. officials, members of Congress, and others raise these issues with President Sisi, because as a first step, the Egyptian authorities often would like to sweep these problems under the rug and suggest that there is no sectarian tension and there is no communal strife in Egypt, and that is simply not the case. So the first step is for us to raise these issues and then to remind Egypt of its national, domestic, and international obligations. Right.
Thank you. I think that's a great answer and a great suggestion, and I appreciate it. And I have limited time, so I just one other question I'll follow up with you. So if the Muslim Brotherhood have an exclusive ideology and democracy is an inclusive process, is the Muslim Brotherhood compatible with democracy?
That is a crucial question and one that is difficult to answer in brief. I believe that at least through 2013, when President Morsi's government was toppled, there were members of the Muslim Brotherhood who were ready to work within and accept a democratic process, while, in my personal view, still hewing to disturbing, illiberal, and intolerant views. But at least it was a first step that there were some members of that group who were willing to participate in elections and participate in a democratically elected government. However, once President Morsi was in power, we saw a lack of regard for human rights norms and many disturbing signs of tendencies toward repression. However, if we actually look at the actual acts and practices, we see that what has taken place under President Sisi, who professes to support democracy, is actually far more abusive and far more brutal and far more disparaging and violating of democratic norms than what took place under previous governments. So I believe that there are many undemocratic actors in Egypt, not just many Islamists, but also other Egyptians who are very enamored of a harsh, repressive security state. So the outcome on the ground is the same, in my view, and it's very disturbing.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you so much. Excellent questions, and good luck with the prayer today. Mr. Connolly of Virginia is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Ms. Hawthorne, your testimony is the current crackdown is worse than that under Morsi and worse than that under the Mubarak government, correct? That's a pretty hard statement. It seems to me that if you don't create political space, you are inviting repression and authoritarian regimes, because there is no alternative. I don't know why we were surprised when Mubarak fell that the only viable electoral alternative was the Muslim Brotherhood. They were the only ones who had organized, however surreptitiously, and no other political dissent had been allowed with our complicity. And we're doing it again under this military-led government. And my friend from California, Mr. Rohrabacher, warned us that if we didn't support this government, the alternative was radical Islamic terrorism. I fear that without questioning this government, without challenging this government, without holding it to certain standards, that isn't precisely the alternative. We will create that alternative, not by design, but because we've created no political space in Egypt. The largest Arab population in the world. The idea that there's only this military-led government, or chaos and the void, seems to me an unacceptable proposition for the American people and the American government, and we have to use whatever levers available to us, and we've talked about that a little bit in terms of foreign assistance, to try to effectuate a better outcome and a better performing government. One that is more inclusive and certainly does not resort. I mean, when you say, Ms. Hawthorne, that the current crackdown is worse than Morsi, whatever one wants to say about the Muslim Brotherhood government, and God knows I have no truck for the Muslim Brotherhood government, but they did get elected freely and fairly according to the United States government. Is that not correct? Did they mow down thousands of Egyptian citizens in the streets of Cairo and Alexandria? Ms. Hawthorne?
No, they did not.
No, they did not. That's a kind of a big measuring stick, it seems to me. However repressive or anti-democratic tendencies they may have been showing at the time of the overthrow, they did not do what this government has done against its own citizens. And I'm not trying to create a favorable comparison, but I think we, America, we need to realistically look at what has been wrought in Egypt. And I believe that repressive government in Egypt plays into the hands of the very elements we want to oppose and we do not want to strengthen. Ambassador Green, what about that? You all, IRIs on the ground over there, you've had people who have been victimized by this government and the previous government. What's your sense?
Well, thank you, Congressman. If nothing else, your statement about the importance of political space, we absolutely agree with, that there must be political space created for people to engage in a safe space with their government. And what we worry about is ongoing alienation of youth, the next generation. And if they grow up in a society with no safe space, no opportunities to engage with their government and with their society, what will be the long-term ramifications? Will you have an entire generation that knows nothing else but what they are seeing right now? And obviously, none of us would support that. That would be a terrible thing.
And maybe that, given my limited time, Ambassador Green, we could talk just a little bit. I'm going to invite you to describe the process. But when I met with the NGO the young people from the NGOs who are unfortunately being prosecuted by their government. These were young idealists committed to making their country a better place. I mean, you couldn't have asked for a better sense of citizenship. And in fact, one worried about their idealism being perhaps crushed by the government. Most of them come from middle and upper middle class families. There are means to be put on trial in a courtroom in Cairo. What happens? Are you put in a jury?
They are not. They do not receive the same legal protections or opportunities, obviously, that we see in the United States or in nearly all of the civilized world. And it goes back to my strong belief that alienation of youth is one of the most dangerous conditions. Left unaddressed, it will guarantee more authoritarian government. It will guarantee an unsustainable security situation.
And the disillusionment of a cadre of young people who actually believed in democracy.
Very much so.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And thank you, Mr. Connolly. We now proceed to Congressman Ron DeSantis of Florida.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate Chairman Ros-Lehtinen holding this hearing. I think that this is a very important subject. And I agree with a lot of the concerns about what's going on in the Egyptian society, but I also don't want to view the Muslim Brotherhood with any type of rose-colored glasses. I think that we should designate them as a foreign terrorist organization. We've passed it out of the One House Committee already, and it's awaiting floor action. I think that they're not part of the solution in the Middle East, but part of the problem. So let me ask you, putting aside the problems that are going on in Egyptian society, Ambassador Green, is President al-Sisi a more reliable ally to the United States in combating Islamist terror than a Muslim Brotherhood-led government would be?
Thank you, Congressman. I'm not sure I'm qualified to comment necessarily on the security situation, but what I can comment on is very clearly former President Morsi and the Muslim Brotherhood were leading Egypt down a very, very dangerous path towards combative, violent Islamic extremism. You know, there is simply no doubt of that. My fear and what my testimony is today is that in the 3 years since then, I worry that the clamping down on civil society and human rights is making the situation, or certainly not improving the situation.
What is the, I think we saw Mubarak is removed, they do an election, and really the default political movement is political Islam. And we saw that with the Brotherhood winning, the Salafists did well in that election. So, I'm concerned as well with what you're talking about with civil society, but are there competing ideologies at play? Are there people who are trying to offer a more, appetizing view of the role of government and individual liberty in Egypt right now?
I think one of the dangers is when you have a total clampdown on civil society and the opportunities for citizens to engage their government, there is no pluralism, and that's a very dangerous thing. So, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And again, we believe that there needs to be political space for people to express themselves. We recognize the security challenges that the government faces, but certainly from the perspective of the U.S., there's every reason that we should be clear-eyed in our analysis, and we should be honest and straightforward with those with whom we engage.
Mr. Awad, what would you say is President al-Sisi, is he a more reliable ally in combating Islamist terror than a Brotherhood-led government would be?
On that narrow question of reliability, to rely on a member of the Egyptian military over a member of the Muslim Brotherhood to combat terrorists, the short answer is yes. There was a question asked earlier about whether or not the Muslim Brotherhood is compatible with democracy. That question can be debated, but I believe they're wholly incompatible with liberal democracy. I'm not really sure this is a question that's necessarily up for debate. The Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood, that is. On the question of whether or not they're a foreign terrorist organization, I don't necessarily see evidence that the entire organization is a terrorist organization. That does not make them pacifists. They have problematic views. They have proven themselves to be...
They support groups like Hamas, though.
They do support groups like Hamas. However, we're talking about material or financial support. The extent of that has to be investigated to be able to make a designation that every
member... They also provide the intellectual contours for really rigid political Islamism. And and one of the things I appreciated with President al-Sisi, and again, I think I agree with you guys on the problems with the civil society, was that he gave a speech in front of a lot of clerics in 2015 and just made the point that he's a devout Muslim, but you can't have the faith used to be antagonistic to every single person in the world who disagrees with that. I would imagine that view would be rejected by the hierarchy of the Brotherhood, correct?
That is true. And let me clarify, there is increasing evidence that one faction inside the Muslim Brotherhood has engaged in violence since January of 2014, at least. Some of their members have engaged and do engage in violence. The question here is not, again, whether the Muslim Brotherhood is a pacifist organization or a problematic one. It is. It is incompatible with liberal democracy, and its views are regressive. But for the United States, when designating a foreign terrorist organization, if we want to take a step like that, perhaps we should look at the specific individuals or the specific faction that's actively engaging in these things, because there are many members of the Muslim Brotherhood who may hold regressive views, like members of white supremacist groups here in the United States, that we wouldn't necessarily designate as terrorists. But again, the lack of designating as terrorists does not mean then that the organization is a good organization or compatible with liberal democracy.
Well, I thank the gentleman for his comments. I would just say I think that what is kind of at the foundation of society, are there pockets where you could actually have more liberal views about the proper role of government? And my fear is that the default is basically the Brotherhood and political Islam, is that that's where the majority, or at least a plurality of the folks are. But I agree, it's tough to figure that out if there's not open channels. But I appreciate the testimony, and I yield back.
Thank you, Congressman DeSantis. And now we'll conclude with our guest, Congressman Dana Rohrabacher of California.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I'm very pleased to hear from our colleagues that we have a Coptic a religious leader leading us in prayer this morning. That's a wonderful statement for us to make. Let me suggest this. I worked in the White House with President Reagan at a time when the National Endowment for Democracy became real. I mean, I worked with a speechwriting team that developed that concept in his speech before Parliament. And let me note that during that time period, Ronald Reagan, I think one of the reasons we won the Cold War is Reagan became the champion of democracy rather than repression as a way to meet communism. That was part of the basic theory. But let me note this, that what we have today are alternatives between, if the bad guys win, what we have is Islamic dictatorships that will murder people in great number. And, you know, quite frankly, I think that it is when you have some level of repression against groups of people in your society that want to institute a dictatorship, what we did is we used those people who wanted freedom and democracy against a communist regime. We emphasized that, and that's how we won the Cold War. But the fact is, those people in the institutes that we're talking about were pushing for democracy in communist countries, and what would replace, in other words, the repressive people in those countries were the ones who didn't believe in democracy, and we were supporting by having the same strategy in Egypt and other countries. We are ending up supporting and giving life to elements within that society that don't want more democracy. So I would suggest that pushing for against restrictions, especially during a time when hundreds of Egyptian people are being murdered, or if soldiers are being killed in a battle against radical Islam, at a time pushing them at that point to a standard, a democratic standard, that would be the, that we believe should be the standard in ordinary times, perhaps makes it more likely that there will be a repressive government rather than less likely. Meaning, in the end, I believe General Sisi, now President el-Sisi, wants a democratic Egypt. And for us to undermine him now we might end up creating a horror story in terms of radical Islamic terrorism throughout the region, but also the people of Egypt will be less, would be less free. If the radical element, if the Muslim Brotherhood element succeeds. Now, with that suggestion, let me ask about the blasphemy law. You mentioned the blasphemy rules or law. How many people have been prosecuted for blasphemy laws in Egypt?
I believe that in recent years it's been in the dozens.
In recent years?
Yes,
in
it's
dozens.
Been in the dozens.
So that means last year maybe one.
No, I think it was significantly more than that.
Okay, well,
I'll have to check
five,
my notes,
then.
But I think it was more
ten.
Than five, in the dozens.
Okay, so in the dozens over a number of years. Tell me, in the other parts of the Middle East, how does that stack up with the rest of the countries in the Middle East?
Well, first of all, Egypt has a much larger Coptic Christian population than many other countries.
Right.
So the
that's because they have relative freedom of religion compared to all the other countries in the Middle East.
I think it's very troubling. I mean, a recent incident that sort of highlighted some of the dilemmas that are occurring in Sisi's Egypt today is that a group of Coptic Christian teenagers who filmed...
Hold on. I'm asking a question here. I don't want you to go on about your philosophy. We understand. I agree with what you're saying, but I'm asking a specific question. Doesn't Egypt rank really high up on the scale when compared to other Middle Eastern countries? In terms of freedom of religion, blasphemy, et cetera?
In some respects, there are positive signs, and other respects...
Is the answer yes or no?
I think it's a mixed picture.
Okay.
President Sisi has said some important things, but actions on the ground continue to be increasingly intolerant.
All right. I got a limited amount of time. That's why I can't let you go on. The bottom line is, I've been to the Middle East, we've all been to the Middle East, to compare Egypt under attack by radical Islamic forces that hate us, that would murder us, as well as murder all the people in Egypt that disagree with them, to compare them to us and the rest of the Western world, Europe, is wrong, it's bad, it will result in more tyranny and not less. What is fair is to compare Egypt to the other Muslim countries in that region, and I know it sounds like you're very hesitant to say it, I'm not hesitant to say it. Egypt ranks way up there on the top of that scale. It's positive as compared to Qatar, as Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, all of these countries that we're talking about that you could compare it to legitimately. Egypt ranks, gets an A-plus compared to them. Now, I think it's totally unfair, especially when this country is under attack. Their people are being murdered. You got the soldiers being killed, 900 soldiers. What would happen if 900 American soldiers, by the way, in proportion, that's about 90,000 American soldiers being killed. And then to hold Egypt to that standard is wrong. And Mr. Chairman, just indulge me in one more moment. I do not believe that radical Islamic terrorists are really alienated Democrats. I don't believe that for a minute. This idea that because there's been clampdowns on certain people that shouldn't, maybe shouldn't be clamped down. Look, anytime you let the government bureaucracy go, they make mistakes and they put people, they target people. They do that. We've had our own people targeted here by our own government in terms of the IRS, et cetera, for disagreement. But the radical Islamicists that are a threat to us now are not people who believed in democracy, but they were upset that they knew someone who was repressed by a repressive government. These are people who have a philosophy, an ideology, like communism did during the Cold War. The fact is that communists believed in what they believed in. They believed in a dictatorship of the proletariat. That idea was defeated, but we recognize what that was. Today, radical Islamic terrorism is affecting the entire world and threatens especially the democratic world. General Sisi, and now who's now President el-Sisi, the fact is, if his government does not succeed because we have been too idealistic and compared him to other standards, that the Western standards of people who are not under attack, and we lose that this government to a radical Islamic government, the whole world will suffer and we will be in jeopardy. With that said, thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Congressman Connolly.
If I might be allowed just a brief response.
That's a unanimous consent thing. As long as you promise that someday I get that opportunity when you've recruited me.
Absolutely.
Okay,
got it. I simply wanted to say that I don't know that we disagree. To be a critic of the el-Sisi government is not to view terrorists as lapsed Democrats. Some of us want to see, like you do, Mr. Rohrabacher, Egypt as a bulwark against terrorism and extremism. The question is how best to do that. And some of us respectfully, including the witnesses here today, believe that the path el-Sisi has gone down actually will not yield that result. We'll do the opposite, not by design, but by practice. Now, maybe we're wrong, and I hope we are, but it's worthy of examination because my friend and I share the same goal. It's a question of how best to get there. I don't believe the best way to get there is by killing your own citizens, by clamping down on civil liberties, by imprisoning and trying young idealist NGO staffers who are trying to make for a better Egypt. I believe that those actions are almost designed to play into the hands of the very people you and I want to prevent from coming to power. And that's the debate. It's not an either-or choice of do you like terrorists or do you want a military strongman who cracks down on all dissent. There has to be another alternative, making this better, creating political space so that we aren't faced with a black and white either or alternative. And that's just my point of view.
And I'd like to thank, as we conclude, Congressman Rohrabacher and Congressman Connolly for their input. And we appreciate so much the witnesses here today. And again, I just have to restate IRI, NDI, the National Endowment for Democracy, what a difference it makes around the world, providing opportunity. And I just wish the success of each of you. We are now adjourned.